Yeah, again, it comes down to consistency. Yeah, I think that at the end of the day, when we look at bubble teams in the professional RLCS realm, if they are strong enough to contend with the top teams and they get a chance to contend with the top teams, they inevitably get better, whether it's a little, lots of different story. And I think we see the same thing here.
Hey, welcome.
I'm following the CRL for a number of seasons.
It
has lots of different names in it, out of Durham. But generally,
you've got bad weather getting ready to come in the DSW area.
These teams have just been in this league for so long, I'll probably back out, it's almost inevitable that they would be improving. Going up against teams like Northwood.
Keep a better eye on my weather.
So I think we definitely see that in the Western Conference. Very similar, honestly. The Texans and the other couple of teams out there. really have turned things up. UNT are numero uno, seeming. But Arizona and LSU are both battling for that. All three of them could be number one, given any sort of games stats. I think the Western Conference is just as competitive as Eastern.
I think there's a slightly bigger divide between the haves and the have-nots in the West versus the North. But let's face it, nobody's looking to win here by being here in the playoff. You have absolutely earned it.
You might have a team kind of stumble into the back door here. Something else I got going on. My 12-year-old and I are making homemade ice cream for the first time in forever. Probably since she was about three.
That's going to tell us a lot about how this playoff picture is going to pan out.
I'm very surprised to see Arizona as far up as they are.
Fred, are they played more than everybody else? I'm trying to get my news going. I've just got a little bit of a lull here, a little warm-up in practice. I've already entered, so it's going to be the cutoff. Arizona, I wouldn't say they're comfortable yet while they're sitting number two. They could end up last night I had a third or fourth place finish.
Didn't play too bad last night. It's always kind of weird playing when you solo queue, especially when you solo queue into a doubles team. Where your teammates are mic'd up and they're communicating. And you're out of the loop, so oftentimes I end up playing a lot of backfield and midfield. Because I've realized and noticed that a lot of times when teams are, or when you have a couple of guys that are mic'd up together, they tend to ball chase a lot more. They tend to both be up front pushing the ball rather than doing a real rotation.
We are in disagreement with
and if they're not doing a real solid rotation, then that gets me stuck in the back a lot. And I don't really think that's fully beneficial to our team, even if I was the worst player on the team. Because as long as you have good solid rotation, it's going to be tough to get scored on. I've got a lot going on. I've got in the background here, I've got the CRL playing. I was trying to listen to it. There's so much noise going on between me watching the news and that. My daughter in there is screaming. Oop, sound like grandkids are here too. I'll be right back.
I think this is a chosen season for UC Dev. I still think Oregon is a fine team here. They're a competitive team. They are a good team in the Western Conference. I don't know if they're the same team that we've seen. The loss of AJC has certainly hurt Oregon. There was something special about AJC at Dusky, and it's nothing against Dinnick here, but it just feels like it is very much different here with Dinnick. So Oregon, I think they're still trying to figure that out. I don't know what it is, but for them right now, it is not
Pick the
really think this is going to be a close one, as you see aggression already apparent in the first 25 seconds of gameplay as the demo came out.
First 30 seconds come and go. Now on the attack, you see Dallas forcing Leland to take it to the corner, and Leland doing some work. Look at the corner boost here as well, but gets demoed. Leland, if he dodges that demo, that would have been a great attacking opportunity. Imminent jumping and missing on that ball. Not a play you'd expect to see him make, but a nice pass. The shot towards net, and that one, a stretching save from Luby. But you can see how quick this Oregon team can get on the attack.
Yeah, these top of the line teams. It's going to take a little more to get past them, and that one almost got past the defender, but just too wide. But that initial unselfishly dump it off to your teammate.
The Skippy helping Imminent pass those stats, getting around two defenders. That was all the Skippy. That was absolutely lovely.
Love seeing those smart heads-up play. Pushing down the field, and then, like I alluded to, just unselfish. Doesn't mind passing that ball in. All I care about is getting that W. And what a pump in mid-air. But unfortunately, it didn't pan out. And again, another shot launched on target. Good defense here in the first 2 minutes of gameplay for Morgan.
Yeah, the Skippy, you see him reading that ball the whole way. Being able to get back in that position now. Low boost situation. Skippy still coming out on top. See him not wanting to commit. Will get the tap above net. Rebound comes out to Luby, and it's a light hit to the corner. And Skippy, dangerous hit. But Leland will bail him out.
That was a dangerous clear there from Dalton. Just gave it right over to Skippy after he picked up that full boost pad. Nice passing so far from Morgan. And there it is, all the way down the field into the back of the net.
It's refreshing to see this type of passing. You see Imminent with the give and go with Leland. And finishing it off with a quality strike. Oregon not messing around.
You just don't know when a shot's going to be coming out.
That's going to be spraying
off
this.
Here it comes, and no, it's another pass, so puts you out of position. Great plays here for Morgan.
All right, sorry, I'm back. Kid yelling at everybody. Of course I'm going to be famous. I'm already famous. What are you talking about, dude? Do I want to be famous? I am famous. I'm the infamous Red Rum. Boost here. Keep in mind, I haven't played today yet. We're straight into this tournament. Oh, these guys are going around. Guys in the worst position.
Yeah,
with them on the counterattack, and that has been working brilliantly for Oregon. And then on top of that, you have these plays in the corner where someone from Oregon's waiting in the right spot in the midfield to receive the play as it's coming out. So good start from Oregon. Can they keep it going? Where they start to cool off.
That just speaks volumes of not only that trust between one another, but the confidence in yourself to be able to say, hey, I'm going to pass this ball to you and be able to put it right on the money. That's the difference maker right there. Gizkevi's got one going up and can't find the left corner. They're not done. Oregon, ooh, a little awkward rotation there from Leland, trying to cut off Emmitt and stalls out their offense.
There though, Oregon was low on boost. That play from Gizkevi was on low boost as well. However, Oregon's not letting it slow down. You can see how well Oregon's been able to keep this ball elevated in front of the UT Dallas net.
And still, only a minute's gone by, and you think, okay, UT Dallas figured them out, they're slowing down. No, game one. First goal wasn't scored until about 3 minutes, 40 seconds into that one. So Oregon right where they want to be, but UT Dallas break out in that hard shot. What a rotation from Gizkevi. Already back on that back line.
Gizkevi having that shot right at him. This is a chance. Dalton to pass to Luby. Denied by Gizkevi, but Ghost is there for the shot. It'll be wide.
Oh.
And that was another scoring chance for UT Dallas.
Oh, and now it's a goal!
Hitting the crossbar, bounces down, and then back above the crossbar. Heartbreak there for Oregon.
Everybody misses. Even the best players in the world. And as I say that, Luby, big swing and a miss on that. But that's one where you want another stab at it. You want to try again because your teammate gets that goalie off of the goal line and out of the picture. You've got nothing but time, and I think that was his worst enemy was right there. It was too much time to look at that shot.
And we've all been. I mean, you know, when you have the time and the runway and everything points to you scoring a goal, a lot of times those are harder ones to put in.
Nice double chance
imminent, too high, and the save from Luby on Leland's follow-up. Back-to-back chances now for Oregon. That shot will test Leland, and Leland will pass. Another hit back out in front of net. Oregon scrambling, Luby off the sidewall. Dalton with the 50, kicks it back out to the middle. Gizkevi will lob it high, gets up possession. Everyone from Oregon scrambling for boost. Now imminent, coming back into the play. 50, it's going to send it downfield. It's going to wave dash to it. Picks up the mid-boost as well. Backboard bounce, chance for Gizkevi. The bounce shot, going to be denied. Luby hitting that off his own crossbar to keep it out of net.
Incredible defense there, and I'm loving the ideas we're seeing from UT Dallas of just launch that ball on target from midfield when they're trying to break out.
Oh! He saved
that!
I was with you, Subi. I was thinking this was an own goal.
Oh, my.
UT Dallas not giving up on the play. Corner bounce, though. Luby has to get the touch. He does. Booms it downfield. Dalton with the 50. Gizkevi out of boost. Goes off the corner. Luby racing to it. Leland can't get back. And Luby will take the lead for UT Dallas.
Eventually, that fast-break offense working for UT Dallas. And that is a great challenge in midair. But still, Dalton able to get a touch on it, put it into the corner. And just like that, UT Dallas strike and take the lead.
So much pressure was on imminent there to at least get a 50. Leland was far back on low boost as well.
Ghost?
I didn't even think he had a chance at this.
What a read, and somehow gets the double? All right, well, goal of the night so far.
They flip it now. Ghost, you're watching this replay. Ghost, that was a nice shot.
you deserve top three.
Gizkevi getting Tenmo down in the air. Leland. Back wall. Luby. Trying to find Ghost, but Gizkevi. Only one there. Leland dropped it back
quit like that happened and you say, are they playing casual? No, they're going for that on the roster channel in CRL to maintain fourth place so that they can get to the playoffs. That was crazy.
I think the most impressive part of that was is 0 seconds. It's got to be on the money. He can't bounce it in. He's got to be perfect with that. Coming off the ceiling and putting that much heat behind it. But game two, quite the different story than game one. And James, I really think it's due to the fact that UT Dallas continuing to launch balls from their own half onto the Oregon net, which forces Oregon to spread out so they can't be as aggressive as offense. And those infield passes aren't quite there. And this is going to be an opportunity. Goes, puts it on target, and Emmitt can't catch up. And UT Dallas again just launched the ball all the way downfield.
And that's heartbreaking. I mean, what we just saw happen, you see it happen once all the time, where you're going for the goal, and you bounce it off the side of the wall, the side of the goal, and no one, and then you can't be back. Unfortunately, for Oregon, all three attackers were up, and after that hard hit came out,
deflected wide. Dalton coming up with the save.
More peace of mind with a one-year appearance protection warranty. If you lose your key fob, it's replaced. Scratch up your wheels, they're fixed. Roadside assistance and so much more, all on every new and used vehicle in stock at no charge to you. Get the details now at claycooley.com and see the benefits of buying with us. Come see Clay.
The future depends on teachers. Right now, in a classroom somewhere in the United States, there is a teacher inspiring a future scientist who'll make preventing pandemics their life's work.
Sharpening the mind of an aspiring environmentalist who'll help combat climate change.
And generating possibilities for a student who'll become the first in their family to graduate college.
Explore a career that leaves a legacy you can be proud of. Shape the future. Teach.
You don't know what'll happen tonight. To you first.
Hello, everybody. I'm Heather Hayes.
And I'm Steve Eager. It's 9 o'clock.
Here for you, first at 9, Fox 4. You can watch Fox 4 News from anywhere right now. Open your phone. Scan the QR code on your screen now to download the Fox 4 News app. It's constantly updated, delivers breaking news alerts and live newscasts. And it's free. The Fox 4 News app. One more way we're here for you. Fox 4.
You fill up my senses. Come fill me again.
Make sure you're connected to Fox 4 News over the air. For help with digital antennas, rescanning, and more, call 214-720-3049. Always local, always here for you. Fox 4.
Foster care, huh?
What's that?
25,000 kids will age out of the foster care system.
25,000?
Yeah, and be completely on their own in this pandemic.
Just talking about foster care can help foster care.
Hey!
Wrong meeting.
Donate your small talk.
Let's get back to brunching instead of late night munching. Before we can safely come together, we need the facts on COVID-19 vaccines. Visit getvaccineanswers.org so you can make an informed decision when vaccines are available to you.
Take a look at this photo courtesy of our Fox 4 storm chaser, Russ Contreras, who's down around the Eastland County area tracking a storm near a rising star. That's a photo that he shot earlier this afternoon. That storm has already been warned for some large hail and damaging wind gusts. And initially, at least for the next couple to few hours, the primary severe weather threat will be west and southwest of the Metroplex, but those storms are expected to ramp up in coverage and intensity as they move towards the I-35 corridor this evening. There's your tornado watch in effect until 9 o'clock. For the present time, it does not include anywhere in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, Wise County, Parker County, down to the Granbury and Glen Rose areas to the west. A flash flood watch will go into effect later this evening and continue into tomorrow morning. That includes roughly the northern half of North Texas, including Dallas, Tarrant, Denton, and Collin counties. Here's a look at our severe weather threats through tonight. Large hail and damaging winds, the two primary threats. The strongest storms could produce up to 70 mile an hour wind gusts, hail up to the size of tennis balls, isolated tornadoes. I think that main threat is going to be to the west and southwest of the Metroplex, and localized flooding is certainly a possibility with these storms, with that flash flood watch in effect. The timing of these storms between now and 9 o'clock, if you live west of the Metroplex, roughly 7 p.m. until 1 a.m. for the most active weather here in the Metroplex and the I-35 corridor, and finally to our east, 9 p.m. until 3 a.m. Had a couple of storms that developed this afternoon pretty quickly. For more on where those storms are now, let's get it over to meteorologist Allie Turiano. Allie?
Thanks, Dan. So a lot of this activity so far that has been strong to severe has stayed well to the west, southwest as expected. We have a few heavier downpours elsewhere. I'll show you those in a moment. First off, our severe thunderstorm warning goes until 5:30, so just a little while longer. We've seen these two different cells split, the one now north of Eastland a little bit weaker than what we're seeing south that's moving into the Gorman area here momentarily. So here's just an estimated arrival time. This is likely going to still at least be strong as it makes its way to Stephenville by 6:10 this evening. So up to a half dollar sized hail and 60 mile an hour gusts remain possible with that one. We head closer to the Metroplex and points north where we still see some showers. This is just a run of the mill activity. Nothing too big of a concern here just yet, but the big story will be what we see develop here in our west and southwestern counties over the next couple of hours. And then, as Dan mentioned, we do expect that activity to increase in coverage.
Thank you, Allie. The upper level low itself, which is really the primary focus here for us weather-wise, is still west of the El Paso area. This is going to play a factor in our weather not only tonight, but right through the upcoming weekend, it looks like. Rainfall forecast here, pretty impressive over the next 48 hours. The bulk of the rain will likely fall tonight into tomorrow morning. 2 to 3 inches looks likely, with isolated amounts of up to 4 inches. So let's play out future cast here. I think the main area of concern, at least for the next few hours, is going to be to our west and southwest, with some supercell storms that will be capable of all modes of severe weather. This will eventually consolidate into a line of storms that will march towards the Dallas-Fort Worth area as we head through 8 to 9 o'clock this evening, and then continue to track eastward. That's 10 o'clock. We'll bring it up towards a midnight. By midnight, I think the main severe weather threat will be pushing to the east and southeast of Dallas and Fort Worth. And then scattered showers and thunderstorms will continue into tomorrow morning, but that should not be severe with the cooler, more stable air in place by then. We're going to remain below normal temperature-wise here the next couple of days. Another 30% chance of showers and storms this weekend as that upper-level low finally lifts north through the area. We'll clear it out Monday, 89, and another slight chance of storms on Tuesday.
A judge in North Carolina declined to immediately release body camera video of a black man being shot and killed by sheriff's deputies. The shooting of Andrew Brown Jr. has sparked daily protests. Prosecutors today said Brown hit the deputies with his car before being shot, but the judge won't allow the public to see it for themselves. Fox's Griff Jenkins reports.
A judge in North Carolina denying a petition to publicly release the body camera footage related to the deputy-involved shooting of Andrew Brown Jr. Brown's family, however, will be allowed to view the video, but the sheriff's office cannot release it to the public for at least 30 days.
The release at this time would create a serious threat to the fair, impartial, and orderly administration of justice.
Brown was killed 1 week ago as deputies attempted to serve a drug-related warrant. In the days since, Brown's family, protesters, and the Pasquotank County Sheriff have all called for the release of the body cam video.
We have to have transparency, and that accountability will follow.
During the hearing, prosecutors argued that Brown hit deputies with his car before the shooting, while Brown's family maintains his car was stationary when the shooting started.
Now, I heard statements being made where he might have hit the deputies, or he might have did that. Well, show us the video. If that exonerate the law enforcement officer, the media would have already seen it.
Results of an independent autopsy finding that Brown was shot 5 times with one fatal bullet entering the back of his head.
I'm tired of spilt blood.
Protests continuing in Elizabeth City Wednesday for the 7th straight day. The mayor here enacting an 8 p.m. curfew Tuesday night, which will remain in effect until further notice. In Elizabeth City, North Carolina, Griff Jenkins, Fox News.
The NASA astronaut who was the command module pilot for the Apollo 11 mission to the moon has passed away. Michael Collins was part of the three-man Apollo 11 crew. He guided his crewmates Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin to make their historic first steps on the moon. Collins
parts of Tarrant County.
Well, I can tell you where we're looking, Scott. I think we're looking right there.
We are looking right there.
Yeah.
So this
is just around Saginaw.
Yeah, this is a great shot. So if you do live in the Saginaw area, here's our truth right now from our SkyCam, picking up on why we are on the air right now and tracking a tornado warning that is indicated by radar. From that shot, I don't see anything that is on the ground right now. That was just a lightning strike. That was not a power flash. But this is what we watch to see if we are going to see that lowering, maybe a tornado touching down. So even though we might not have a tornado on the ground right now, we are seeing the radar definitely indicating this circulation that is showing up. So as we come back to our radar right now, you're able to see this is that circulation. Here's the Saginaw area. This is exactly what we were looking at.
It's trying to get organized again,
right,
Scott.
It is. It's trying to maybe tighten up a little bit more. And that's what happens with these storms. Is they might cycle a little bit. They might drop a little bit, and then they get a little bit more intensity. You notice there how we lost the hook echo, and now it's maybe starting to reform again. So this is why we have the tornado warning, and that's why we're continuing to track it here. All right, we have zoomed in on the SkyCam on Sky 2 a little bit more, so you're able to see that. And I know when you see maybe a couple of things hanging down, you might think, hey, that's a funnel cloud.
No.
It's not. You know, sometimes those are called scud clouds. And it's hard because we need the ground truth that is there to see if these are actually lowering and they are actually rotating. And Jeff and I are both analyzing this relatively quick, and I keep seeing what I think is a funnel cloud.
Well, I think that's the scud squirreling around.
Yeah,
it's trying, Scott.
We're watching
it try to form a funnel right now.
Yeah, so this is what we're watching right now. And, you know, as we analyze with this, you notice that lowering is not as impressive anymore, at least right now, but it's still trying. and we will work on getting our storm chaser back up. We lost his shot for at least right now. But this is now the shot here from our Fort Worth Skycam. You notice it's not as impressive, but again, that cycling is definitely possible as we have this radar-indicated tornado going through parts of Tarrant County. Let's come back to the radar real quick. And if you guys want to double box this at one point, that's fine. So let's go ahead and track the where we're looking at this inflow notch that's happening. Here is Saginaw. There's Watauga. The Keller area, you might be about to get some large hail. So also make sure that you stay away from the windows. This is moving to the east, still near about 30 miles per hour. So Watauga, 834. The Bransford area, 845. Colleyville at 846. So getting some reports of maybe some quarter-sized hail in some spots, but this is the path that we're looking at. Jeff, let's zoom in if we can even tighter and get some street names.
So it's crossing 35 right now,
right.
Scott.
Here is it's crossing 35. Here's the Highway 81 service road, that is. Here is North Beach Street. Here's Old Denton Road. Again, here's 820 when it's crossing 35 and they meet. So this is what we're seeing. So if you live along Denton Highway, here's looks like Whitley Road. Again, Wills Lane, Starnes Road, Hightower Drive. This is on its way to you. The hail, the maybe some of the bigger hail is up 35 a little bit more west of Keller. And this is making its way east also at 30. So it is going to be in Keller in about 2 minutes, 8:32. Again, these are estimated times. Old Union, 8:46. Southlake at 8:46. Grapevine at 8:52. So that's the hail threat. I think the tornado threat is a little bit further down to the south, but the north central sides there of Tarrant County are included in this tornado warning for about another 30 minutes. So it's just now getting this coming in, that tornado warning over 35W just north of Loop 820, as we talked about, Jeff, still moving east at 30. This is coming from the National Weather Service there. So looking a little bit more, we still have that rotation or that hook showing up, not a very well-defined one, not really indicative of a tornado on the ground that we know of, and we're not getting any damage reports from that we're noticing here from the National Weather Service. I know that our assignment desk, our news desk, it would be working on that if we're having any damage reports. But right now, this is the area that we're continuing to watch. And this has been a radar-indicated tornado, Jeff. We haven't seen anything that has touched down. And as we talked about, it would be really hard to see because of all of the rain.
Yeah, and we are looking at it both through our Skycam and through our storm spotters. And we have yet to see anything on the ground. But we have seen this hook form now three times since it crossed the county line. And it keeps on trying to produce a tornado, Scott. You can see the obvious signature now just in the last frame, that it is trying to get wrapped around, and we just have to continue to watch this. This could literally drop any moment.
It really could. So as you're looking at that shot there from our Fort Worth Skycam, we're looking into this area right here. So
and there it goes again.
Yeah, and there it goes again. So it tightened up, and then it wasn't as impressive, and this is hard to see. So if you guys want, I'm gonna step out. If you guys want to pop me up, I'll be able to try to talk about on top of our Skycam real fast. If you guys want to pop me up, just be able to show exactly what we're looking at real fast. Not in the double box. If you guys could just pop me up right over Sky 2. This is what we're looking at least as far as the radar is concerned. But, when you get that, just I can step out. All right, this is what we're looking at. Again, we're losing a lot of the daylight.
You see it lowering
right
down there.
And you see it lowering just a little. I mean, just in that few moments that I was trying to pop up here and kind of show you, this is the area that I was looking at, that it was a little bit more well-defined. And we're zoomed in a little bit more. So that's what I'm looking at. It's a little bit more ragged. Again, we're losing a lot of the daylight, so it's really hard to see. So this is what we're looking at least right now. And it was tightening up and then kind of widening out a bit more. And this is what we're watching to see if we might see something drop at any moment. But right now, we don't have a confirmed tornado that is on the ground. Again, we're getting some reports out of the northeast of Lake Worth area. Large tree on a house off of Boat Club Road. Winds gusting over to 60 miles per hour. News desk, if you are listening to me right now, we do have a damage report coming in of a large tree on a house off of Boat Club Road. This is northeast, about 1 mile northeast of Lake Worth. If you guys can work on that. This is now what we're looking at as far as the hail is concerned. Keller, right now, you're dealing with potentially some 1-inch size hail, maybe some quarter size hail or larger. This is possibly the area of rotation. Again, here is Watauga. Here's Mid-Cities Boulevard. Here's the Bransford area. There's Colleyville. If you live east of this, again, here is North Tarrant Parkway. Here's Bercy Road, Starnes Road, Hightower Drive. As across is Whitley Road, also Denton Highway. You know those streets. This is moving from west to east and is continuing to push its way through your neighborhoods and has the potential of a tornado that is on the ground, or maybe some strong winds or some large hail. As we're sampling the hail size now, we are looking at right along Old Denton Road, again, North Beach Street, possibly hail to the size of a ping pong ball,
yeah,
or up to the size of an egg. This is going to be damaging hail for cars, for homes, so for some of the roofs that are there. Getting report of 2-inch size hail 3 miles west-northwest of Keller Town Center.
We can see it right there,
yeah,
Scott.
So we can see it right there. Look at this. So this is our product here, to be able to see the hail. And here's Pearl Street. There's East Vine Street. This is the large hail. So 2-inch size hail is going to be damaging hail. And when you have that color right there on our radar, that black color, that indicates that damaging hail. And Jeff, we know here in North Texas that when you have hail like that, you're probably going to have some damage.
There's no, yeah, absolutely. The only way you get reflectivity in the black range is large hail. It looks like, Scott, it's trying again down here, down to the south, to get organized. And maybe we can see it better. Again, I'm going to go with the terminal radar. And do you see that right there?
I do.
Yeah. I think it's trying again to get organized in that south flank and trying to produce a tornado again. So we're just going to have to continue to stay on.
Yeah, we're going to have to continue to stay on. We had Mike shot up. We've lost it again. But at any point, control room, if we can just get Mike on the phone to do another phone interview with him, please let us know when he is available. So it looks like it's trying to tighten up again. Mike is now west of where maybe that rotation is and the strongest winds possibly with this storm. And even when I was looking at a shot before it lost it, it looked like he was going into an underpass because he might be getting some of the hail, but it looks like the largest hail is now east of him. So tornado warning does continue until 9 o'clock. That is for the north sides there of Tarrant County. This is not, I mean, it's still there for us. We're still seeing possibly this if we want to switch over the wind, Jeff. We're looking at maybe a broad rotation. Not that impressive. Yes, we still have some of the stronger winds, but I'm not noticing as tight of a circulation, so it might be cycling again.
Yep.
But this is good news, at least for right now. We might be seeing this weakening just a little bit, but I'm not going to stop my concern because, as we know with these storms, they might cycle down, they might cycle back up again. Getting reports now, 2-inch hail core in northeastern Tarrant County over Keller, moving towards South Lake. So this is what we've been tracking. We're gonna get probably some damage reports coming out of there. Here's the Keller area, and look at this hail path. So from near Lakeside, then into near Saginaw, stretching up towards the Keller area on its way to near South Lake. So if you're able to get cars inside the garage, you know, Keller, it's too late. It's over you right now. But hopefully you are away from your windows. This is the first time tonight that we have seen our radar estimate hail possibly up to the size of a tennis ball. That will cause dents in your car. That will cause damage to you if you are outside. So don't run outside and try to cover up your car with a blanket or anything like that. Please stay inside. Stay away from your windows. And just stay with us here on CBS 11. We have Mike Prendergast, our storm chaser, back on the phone now. And Mike, you have changed positions. We have you kind of on the backside of where maybe some of the strongest hail is. Talk us through where you've been and where you moved to and what you've been experiencing.
Yeah, so we were on 820 there
in a northwest, I guess it was westward, when the everything started ramping up. That's when the tornado warning happened, and the rotation moved right over us, kind of in the hook, and it was so intense. The rain and a little bit of hail was really intense. We let it go by us, and then we kind of got behind it again and came up I-35W, and we pulled off at Tarrant Parkway just because we didn't want to get in the huge part of the hail. But we literally went through where the hook is on radar and where all the rotation is, and fortunately I did not see any kind of damage, anything like that. So I don't believe anything touched down, but there certainly was some rotation going on, and now we're kind of on the back side of it, like you said.
Yeah, and we are getting reports of 2-inch size hail through 3-inch size hail in parts of the Keller area. So damaging hail continuing with this storm, Mike. So we appreciate your report. Jeff, we want to pop up where Mike's GPS is at least right now. So, you know, he was traveling along 820. Now he's here on 35 back towards the west. So the storm is further off towards his east. So, Mike, we really appreciate your report and glad that you remained safe. And we are getting some damage reports coming in right now, getting some reports as well, possibly from the National Weather Service, of possibly some hail up to the size of a tennis ball or maybe even a baseball in the Keller area. This report coming in of 3-inch size hail in Moorhen Circle in Keller. So we might be getting some tweets of that, some pictures that are coming in. Control them. If you guys are looking through Twitter, you have any of those that are coming in, just pop them up here on the screen when we're available. But you can see some of the reports now coming in, these local storm reports from the storm that's moving through. So, Jeff, we might be switching from a tornado threat to possibly more of this large hail threat with this storm. That doesn't mean that the tornado warning has been canceled, but, you know, looking at the latest information from the radar, this hail core looks like it's growing a little bit more for me.
Yeah, it's getting bigger, and it's getting more intense, and it's starting to spread now. Now that it's left Keller, it's heading right now towards South Lake and 114. And Scott, we've both been into this area. We know there's a lot of homes. This is a very densely populated area, as most areas, quite honestly, of DFW. But this is going to produce some damage on some roofs. This is large hail.
Yeah, it is large hail. And I have family in the Keller area, and my parents live in the South Lake area. So, you know, guys, stay away from the windows. This is going to be causing some damage, and our news desk is working on seeing if we are seeing any damage, hearing any damage reports from that. It might be a little bit too soon since we still have this storm that's going through. So here is our hail size that is showing up. There's Johnson Road, there's FM, there's 1709, right as you leave Keller, 1709, Johnson Road, and FM 1938. You guys have the pictures on Twitter? All right, this is one of the pictures. All right, so that's about an inch and a half. So, you know, quarter size hail or maybe slightly larger. Again, we're getting a local storm report, Jeff, coming in that from a National Weather Service employee of 2.5 inch size hail. That again is about near the Keller area. So that's just now coming in. So that's a National Weather Service employee definitely is able to know their stuff. So we're still tracking a tornado warning. And Jeff, it's been a while since we were able to track the path of this and how fast it is moving. So let's go ahead and do that if we can right now. The latest look, this is where the strongest hail is going to be going, the largest hail, I should say. South Lake 847, Coppell at 901, and Bethel at 906. We have a hail picture coming in from Jason Allen, who does live in the Keller area, if we can go ahead and pop that up. Again, that's some relatively large hail that's moving through, maybe an inch to maybe an inch and a half. If Jason is willing to talk on the phone at some point, let me know if we can grab him. But this is the hail that moved through the Keller area. And is continuing now to make its way closer towards South Lake at about 8:46. So this is what we're looking at still. We are dealing with a severe thunderstorm warning. A tornado warning that's in effect. National Weather Service is also talking about possibly just a severe thunderstorm warning coming out for parts of southeast Denton County and possibly the downstream into Dallas County. So we're looking at this, still watching this right now, and we're watching the area that at one point possibly had a tornado, no damage from that, that is moving through and is continuing to make its way off towards the east. Let's switch on over to velocity again, Jeff, if we can. And as we're looking at this, not really noticing now a lot of rotation with this.
It's broken apart.
So, yeah, it's broken apart. So what that means for me and Jeff is that we're seeing some maybe some weakening with this. We have Jason Allen on the phone right now, CBS 11's Jason Allen. And Jason, we just showed you a picture of some large hail that was in your neighborhood. Talk about, you know, what it sounded like, what happened when it went through, and if you see any damage.
Yeah, Scott, so we were watching you. I was kind of keeping an eye here as that storm was going through and seeing that track took it right over this area in northern Tarrant County where I am. It's North Fort Worth, kind of as you get into Keller, and could see that hail core was probably going to go right over the top of where I was. So we're kind of prepared for it and watching it. It started very slowly, just with a couple of hailstones here and there, and then there was a big burst of hail, and everything, as you just said, and like that picture that I think you were able to show, was probably golf ball size and bigger. Started out with dime size hail and then got up to golf ball size, and then probably got a little bit bigger from that. It tailed off for a minute or two, and then it just started over again, and you could just hear it hammering this entire neighborhood up here, coming off the roofs, bouncing off the gutters, going off the cars. It wasn't big enough, Scott, to puncture holes at windows, at least not in my house or from what I could tell neighbors' homes. Cars still look to be intact out here, so not those big giant hailstones that you see that are puncturing windshields or windows or anything like that, although there were some stones that were getting up to some dangerous sizes. So I imagine you will see a lot of people having to inspect roofs tomorrow, having to look at new roofs in the morning when they get up. Hopefully there wasn't anything that was big enough to go through windows, but it was a really good, solid storm as it passed through. And there was enough hail, Scott, where it's still littering the ground right now. Some of the lawns almost look like it snowed. There was that much hail that came down out of
it. Yeah. Thanks so much, Jason Allen, for your report there. And thanks for giving us that hail size. I was trying to measure, you know, the length of your fingers as opposed to the hailstone. So we appreciate that report. And thanks for remaining safe. Good news. And as Jeff and I was just analyzing before we talked to Jason, we're thinking that, hey, the winds have brought it out. The tornado warning has been canceled for Tarrant County. So that is some good news. So the threat for the tornado warning has canceled, the National Weather Service has canceled the tornado warning. So as you take a look here, we'll probably continue on CBSN control room. Also, you know, boss, if you want us to hop off here on CBS 11, please let me know. But we can continue on CBSN. We are no longer having a tornado warning here in north sides of Tarrant County. And right now, not even a severe thunderstorm warning, at least for parts of Tarrant County. We do have a severe thunderstorm warning that is in for parts of Denton County until about the Denton County one just popped until 9:45. So we're now, all right, there's a new severe thunderstorm warning. Just as I said that there, Jeff, severe thunderstorm warning, if we want to pop that one up too, for north sides of Tarrant County, if we can click that so I can find the time real fast. There it's until 9 o'clock. So
yeah,
they
it's a
traded
continuation.
The, yes,
yeah.
A continuation. Mm-hmm. The tornado warning now is a severe thunderstorm warning until 9 o'clock. So we are, the main hail core now is presently over South Lake and is continuing over the South Lake area. We've shown you some of the hailstones there that are pretty large, possibly causing some damage. And we are continuing here on CBS 11 as we're tracking this storm that now is continuing to move eastward, and we're switching over to more of a hail threat, at least right now. So, Jeff, you know, we've been looking at this, and we knew through the day that large hail was going to be a possibility as we went into this time frame tonight. And now as we look at this, moving out of the Keller area, now moving into the South Lake area. Before I come to you, Jeff, we have some video coming from Doug Dunbar's house in the Keller area, if you want to pop that up.
This is his backyard.
Yeah, so that's the backyard.
Just right around the pool, and that's, looks like there's some golf ball size.
Yeah, it looks like, I just wanted to stop so we could hear it. And yeah, some golf ball size hail there. Definitely loud. And definitely scary. So this is what's happening. This is what moved through the Keller area. This is what's now moving through the South Lake area. And this storm is continuing to make its way to the east, possibly moving between the Flower Mound, Grapevine area as it moves east, northeast. So golf ball size hail being reported over Trophy Club. with this storm. So let's go ahead and track that now. You notice that it is now moving east-northeast, and moving east-northeast at about 30 miles per hour. So we're giving you Grapevine 849, Flowermount 849, Coppell 857, and Lewisville a little bit after 9 o'clock. And the reason that the southeast sides of Denton County included in this now severe thunderstorm warning is because of that path of the storm that is now moving in the hail path that's moving northeast. So this is the hail track that we talked about coming out of Parker County, moving there into parts of Tarrant County, continuing over the Keller area, and now it's continuing to make its way east and northeast and is passing between Grapevine and Flower Mound here over the next few minutes. Flower Mound has activated the outdoor warning sirens on the eastern side of the city for the hail. We just got that report of a golf ball size hail coming out of Trophy Club. So you're able to see right there, this is the hail that we're looking at. Here's 114, here's Trophy Club, and there's Shady Oaks Drive. This is about to cross over the lake and make its way northeast into Flower Mound, right along Simon Road, and continue to track its way into parts of Denton County. So, it's good to say that we don't have that tornado warning anymore, but unfortunately, Jeff, we're still dealing with the hail threat into tonight. It's 8:48. Again, that tornado warning, I'm sorry, the severe thunderstorm warning for Tarrant County until 9 o'clock, the one for Denton County until 9:45.
And the good news, if there's going to be any good news, it doesn't include the people who are under it, is that that's all that's going on across the Metroplex as far as threatening weather.
Yeah.
We have this hail core that has been producing reports of 3-inch size hail that moved over northern Tarrant County, is now closing in over on Grapevine Lake, and as will be passing in right in into, as we zoom in a little bit closer, make sure that we have the latest on here, but we're watching this hail core go right into Flower Mound now as it crosses the lake, and Coppell and Lewisville, Double Oak, you're going to have the threat of this hail falling over your on your roof as well, because this is this hail core continues to be rather intense. And I think, Scott, it really told the story when we looked at the hail path, because we could certainly see where those reports were coming from, couldn't we? It was right there. It was right on that path.
Yeah, it definitely was right on that path. So I was getting a drink of water there real fast. So this is why we're here on CBS 11, as we have damaging hail moving through the Metroplex and now is continuing to make its way to the north and east, with now two severe thunderstorm warnings that we're tracking. At one point, we were dealing with a tornado warning. Now you see the severe thunderstorm warning expiring at 9:45 for the southeast sides of Denton County. And then again, we have the severe thunderstorm warning for parts of Tarrant County until 9 o'clock. I keep saying tornado warning because we're talking about it for quite some time. But thankfully, we did not have a tornado touchdown. This was all radar indicated. We will see if we get any damage reports from that. At one point, we did have a damage report coming out of the Lake Worth area, possibly a large tree down onto a house there. So the National Weather Service will be getting more reports of that. And again, there is the hail report that came in, and we are 4 miles west-southwest of Keller, possibly 2.5 inch size in diameter hail that is being reported. So it is, again, that large hail threat that we're continuing to track here on CBS 11. So I know we were over the president's address, but when we have that threat of life here in North Texas, we want to keep you and your family safe. And that's why we have our digital streaming channel, CBSN DFW, and right here on CBS 11 and TXA 21. So this is the hail core that we're looking at right now, and this is where the largest hail will continue to track its way into parts of Denton County and right over near Grapevine, between Grapevine and Flower Mound. Now, it looks like we just got the latest update there. And notice, okay, so when we look at this, and you analyze with this, when we're looking at the radar, where you see that black color showing up, that indicates really large hail. That's what we call the hail core. Watch as it is now making its way to near Flower Mound. Let's zoom in a little bit more on that. Still moving east-northeast. It is still there, but not as well defined. So we might be seeing some of the hail coming down in size or intensity. So we now have another hail picture coming in from Keller. If you guys want to pop that up there for me. This is from that hail core that is making its way through. Again, marble-sized hail to possibly a golf ball-sized hail or larger there. So far, no pictures of tennis ball-sized hail, which is good. or baseball size hail, which is good. I'll be happy if we don't have that. It was estimated by our radar, but you're able to see there those hailstones up to the size of a marble or even larger than that, you know, maybe up to the size of a golf ball or ping pong ball, which is very loud and can cause some damage on some of the roofs. So this is the hail core that we are continuing to look at right now. So if you do live in